We're honored to have as our guest today Father Stephen Tsichlis, Senior Pastor of St. Paul Greek Orthodox Church in Irvine, where he has served since 1997 in the metropolis of San Francisco. Father Steve's topic today will be on eating and drinking Jesus and living in the kingdom now. Father Steve received his BA degree from the University of Missouri, St. Louis, and went on to receive a certificate in Greek and Byzantine history from the University of Thessaloniki, Greece. He earned his MDiv degree from Holy Cross Greek Orthodox Seminary and his master's degree in sacred theology from Yale University and studied patristics under the late Father John Langendorf at Fordham University. In addition to his pastoral duties, Father Steve was recently appointed coordinator of the permanent diaconal program for the metropolis of San Francisco. And so it is our joy to welcome Father Steve to us today. Father, it is good to have
you. Okay, let's get rid of my introduction. How's that? Because I have lots of papers and lots of things. Can you hear me? I'm told that the microphone is on. Kevin is adjusting me now. Thank you, Kevin.
Pretty good.
Kevin knows I need all the adjustments I can get. So. So are you ready? I think it's okay, right? I know you're recording this. You're going to be in deep trouble now. So, good morning. Thank you for coming out. It's Saturday morning, so you're all very brave souls for coming out to listen to me today. Thank you, Father Wayne, for blessing my being here, and to Kevin, actually, for inviting me originally. I'd like to begin this morning, actually, by quoting St. John of Kronstadt, who is a Russian priest who died in 1908, a little bit more than a century ago. He says that, if one were to put all of the world's most precious treasures on one side of a scale and the divine liturgy on the other, the scales would tip completely in favor of the liturgy. And then he says, there's nothing upon the face of the earth that is holier, higher, grander, more solemn, and more life-giving than the Divine Liturgy. And that's really what I want to focus on today. If you listen carefully to what he said, all of the world's treasures, all of our gold, all of our silver, all of our money, all of our jewelry, every possession that we could possibly have, in fact, as the devil said to the Lord Jesus when he tempted him, all the kingdoms of this world, if you put all of that on the scale, nonetheless, the scales would tip completely towards the Divine Liturgy. Not just a little bit, but completely and totally. And this coming from a man who celebrated the liturgy every day. Now, the liturgy on Sunday morning, the liturgy is the most important thing that you can do, period. There is no other thing that is more important in your life than attending church on Sunday morning and the liturgy at any other time that you can. There is nothing more important than that. Why? Because we believe that in the liturgy, we find everyone with a capital E and everything that we need for salvation. Christ is fully present in the liturgy. Christ is fully present. He is here with us when we celebrate the liturgy. The Holy Spirit is present and descends not only on the gifts of bread and wine, but on us first. And if you know the prayers that the priest says, he says, we ask, pray, and beg you, send down your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts here presented. We ask for the Holy Spirit to descend upon us first so that we can really be who we say we are,
because we really cannot be Christian even apart from the Holy Spirit. St. Paul will even say no one can even call Jesus the Christ apart from the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is essential to our lives as believers. And we think that the liturgy is therefore a Pentecostal, charismatic event in which we receive not only the body and blood of the Lord Jesus, but we also receive what St. Paul calls, and the text of the liturgy says, the communion of the Holy Spirit. When you eat and drink the body and blood of Jesus, you are also eating and drinking, in a certain sense, the presence of the Spirit. Because without the presence of the Spirit, it would not be the body and blood of Jesus. Now, Christ is there. The Holy Spirit is there. The Bible is there. The scriptures are read. The psalms are sung. And even the very text of the liturgy itself is little more than a string of Bible quotes. And just to get an idea, there was a Russian Orthodox theologian of the last century. He died in 1970. His name was Paul Evdokimov. And he once calculated that just in the text of the liturgy itself, there are 98 quotes from the Old Testament and 114 quotes from the New, just woven into the text of the liturgy. Now, I actually think there are more than that. But that's all he could find. I think there are probably more. And notice that what that means for us is, when we come to church, we come to church to learn how to pray, for one thing. The liturgy teaches us how to pray. A lot of times, people will talk to me about their personal prayer, and they will just simply say, well, you know, I just kind of talk to God. And talking to God is fine. There's nothing wrong with that, per se. But a lot of times, our prayer can become very idiosyncratic and even very self-centered and self-focused. For example, once in Seattle, I was doing a Bible study, and a woman asked me, Father, can I pray that my husband will buy me a mink coat? And the answer was, no, you cannot pray that. But doesn't it say in the Bible somewhere that just ask and you will receive? Yes, but you have to ask according to God's will for your life. Notice that in the Lord's Prayer, we ask for our daily bread. There are no mink coats mentioned. So what we have to understand is that part of what we come to liturgy for is to have the scriptures enter into our hearts and our minds in such a way that we learn how to truly pray, what to pray for, what to ask for, and so that even our very words of prayer will be shaped by the words that God has given us in the scriptures. So it's very important that you pay attention at the liturgy. A lot of times, we as Orthodox Christians, at least those of us who've grown up in the church, we come to liturgy and we basically stand there like crash dummies. We really kind of let the liturgy just flow over us. And maybe we're not even paying attention. One of the things that you hear often in the liturgy is, let us listen attentively. Before everything important, the deacon comes out and says, pay attention to this. Come back from your grocery list. Pay attention to the scripture readings. Pay attention to the creed. Let's get together on this stuff. So our minds will wander during liturgy. But nonetheless, constantly throughout the liturgy, we're called back to pay attention. So we pray the Lord's Prayer in the liturgy. This is the prayer that the Lord Jesus gave to his disciples to pray. And in fact, the fathers and the saints say that the whole of the gospel is contained in the Lord's Prayer. And so that prayer is essential to us. And so we pray it in the liturgy. The liturgy You know, we offer the liturgy to our Father in heaven. So there is a certain sense in which when we're gathered in liturgy, not only is Christ present, not only is the Holy Spirit present, but we are offering our worship to God our Father through Christ in the Holy Spirit. So the liturgy is Trinitarian through and through, and that's why we repeat over and over and over again, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Because the liturgy itself, our very act of worship, is Trinitarian. Through Christ in the Holy Spirit, offering our worship to God our Father. We confess our faith in the Creed. We say, I believe. I believe. Now that word creed in English, credo, credo, if you want to say that, I don't know, in Latin. The root of that word is actually two words in Latin, cor and donato. Literally, what I can give my heart for, what I can give my heart to. So when we confess the creed, the very word itself means that we are at that point offering our heart to God our Father, to the one Lord Jesus Christ, to the Holy Spirit. But also we say, not only do we believe in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we even say we believe in the church. So we are actually offering our hearts in the context of the community, the church as well. So we confess our faith. And of course, the angels are present. The liturgy is constantly talking about the angels. Archangels, thrones, principalities, dominions, the many-eyed cherubim, the six-winged seraphim. We're constantly talking about angels. And when we come out with the gifts, we sing the cherubic hymn, do we not? So we're singing with the angels. So we are actually caught up in the worship of the angels and the saints around the throne of the Lamb, as described in chapters 4 and 5 of the book of Revelation. Now, if you remember that passage from the book of Revelation, those two chapters, one of the things you'll remember is that there are 24 presbyteri there in the original Greek. Normally that word is translated as elders, or old guys. And actually, if you look at two of these three guys sitting in the front, you see Father Michael there, and even I, that would be our title in Greek. We would be old guys, which by and large we are at this point. So that word might normally be translated into English as elder, but in fact the Greek word presbyteros becomes presbyter in Latin, preos in Old English, and then in modern English, priest. And so what you see in the book of Revelation are the 24 elders, the 24 presbyters, gathered around the throne of the Lamb, dressed in white robes, as priests are during the celebration of the liturgy, and holding golden bowls full of incense.
Sound familiar? I hope so.
You can see that our worship in the church is patterned after the worship that goes on from all eternity to all eternity around the throne of the Lamb in his kingdom. And here I want to stress that point. The liturgy is not merely something we do, although we're commanded by Christ to do it. He says, do this in remembrance of me. So it is a command. It's not an option. And that's why the basis for our worship on even a day-to-day basis, but certainly on a Sunday-to-Sunday basis, is the Eucharist, is the liturgy. We do not interpret that passage allegorically. We take it literally. Okay? Do this. And so we do it. But it's not merely something that we do. It's something that we enter into. And that's important for you to understand. Because what we do when we come to church is to enter into the worship that is already going on around the throne of the Lamb from all eternity to all eternity. We come here to participate in that worship. And in fact, Our worship here is meant to be an icon of that worship going on in the kingdom of God. Now, in fact, then, we even sing about this. Now, when we sing the cherubic hymn, this is really part of what we're seeing. I don't know what translation you all use here at St. Barnabas, but normally, at least in the Greek archdiocese, the translation runs something like this. We who mystically represent the cherubim sing the thrice holy hymn to the life-creating Trinity. We who mystically represent is what I want to focus on. In the original Greek text, it says, "E ta cherubim mystikos ikonizondes." Now, we who mystically, and of course, the cherubim, the angels, but the Greek word that's used there, ikonizondes, is literally the word icon used as a verb. So that when you come to church to celebrate the liturgy, what you do here is meant to be an icon of the worship going on around the throne of the Lamb in the kingdom. And by being an icon, we believe you participate in that worship. Because the icon participates in the reality that it depicts. And so we come here to conform our hearts and our minds to that reality rather than just simply the reality of this world. We'll talk about that a little bit more in a few minutes. So when we come to church, we have to recognize that as soon as we walk through that door, as soon as we enter the building, we are to become living, breathing, walking, talking icons. Which, by the way, we already are. We just don't realize it very often. We have all been created, as Genesis says, in the image and likeness of God. Kat ikona keoniosis is the Greek of the Septuagint. So we are already living, walking, talking, breathing icons. That's why we even are asked to exchange a kiss of peace during the liturgy. Just like we kiss the icons as we come in, we kiss the icon of our brothers and sisters who are icons of Christ, icons of God. So, we come here to be an icon. We come here to be who we really are and what we're called to be. Now, so we believe our worship then is an icon of the worship of God going on in heaven. And that's really what happens at St. Paul's. It's really what happens at St. Barnabas. It happens in every Orthodox church around the world, every Sunday, and every time the liturgy is celebrated. So with us, with the angels and the saints, all standing before God, the church is fully gathered. And I know that most of you do not see this, but we as priests do. That is an exact image of what's on the paten, on the plate, that we have the bread that will become for us the body of Christ, but also a triangle representing the Theotokos, 9 triangles representing the angels and all the saints, and then the living and the dead whom we pray for. All gathered around Christ. All gathered around, in a certain sense, the throne of the Lamb. So we see that image as priests. It's unfortunate that as laity we cannot. But it's there in the liturgy. It's there. So, the church is fully gathered. Heaven and earth at that point intersect. And if we have eyes that really see, and ears that really hear, if our hearts and minds are open to the reality of the liturgy, we participate in the kingdom of God now. Now, at that moment, as soon as we walk through that door, we begin participating in the kingdom of God. That's why in the Trooper hymn we also sing, "Now let us lay aside all worldly cares." We leave stuff at the door. We leave our garbage at the door. And we come in to be healed by the Word of God, to be healed by the Spirit of God, to lay aside all that stuff that hinders us, so that God can do His work on us when we come here. Now, what that means is, because a lot of people seem to think that the kingdom of God, you know, it's kind of like Star Wars in a galaxy far, far away, a long, long time ago, you know. The kingdom of God is coming. And it is. In its fullness. But we believe that we participate in the kingdom of God now when we come to liturgy. And in fact, that is the pledge of our future inheritance. St. Paul uses that phrase to describe the gift of the Holy Spirit. And of course, the Holy Spirit is present throughout the liturgy. And when we receive communion, as I said, we not only receive communion in the body and blood of Christ Himself, but we also receive the communion of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is here to work on us, and we participate in the reality of the kingdom now, not at some future date, not sometime in the distant future, but actually right now. In other words, the liturgy is, to use that fancy theological term, eschatological, is Greek word, you know, has to refer to things at the end of time, the judgment day. But even more than that, when we celebrate the liturgy, when we come here to participate in worship on Sunday morning, we participate in the present, in the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper, just as the disciples did nearly 2,000 years ago, and we participate in the marriage supper of the Lamb that's talked about in the 19th chapter of the book of Revelation, celebrating the wedding of the Lamb with His bride, the church, us. And I want to read that to you because I think it's important for you to understand some of this. It's a very beautiful passage. I know Orthodox Christians tend to shy away from the book of Revelation, and probably wisely so. But there are some things there that we can understand. So, the subtitle here is The Marriage Supper of the Lamb. And from the throne came a voice crying out, "Praise our God, all you, His servants, you who fear Him, small and great." Remember, we come forward in the liturgy to receive communion with the fear of God. "Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the sound of many waters, like the sound of mighty thunder, crying out, 'Alleluia!'" You ever hear that in the liturgy? I hope so. "For the Lord our God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give Him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and the bride has made herself ready." When we come to church, we are the bride of Christ, collectively and individually. We come here for that, to be His bride, to be in that kind of intimate relationship with Christ that only the Holy Spirit can give. "It was granted her to be clothed with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. When you get baptized," here at St. Barnabas, "what are you wearing when you come up out of the baptismal font? What do they throw on you immediately?" Well, don't just sit there like crash dummies. You can say something. "White robes, thank you, deacon." Whoa. White robes. The white robes, it says here in the book of Revelation, represent the righteous deeds of the saints. We enter the water broken, sinful, old, corrupt, stupid, and we come out new. We come out a new creation, St. Paul says. Kenithesis. We come out totally new. And we put on this white robe. And by the way, for us as priests, I don't know what kind of robes you guys are wearing these days, but the very first garment that a priest puts on is his sihari, right? It's the white, normally it's supposed to be white garment. Nowadays, of course, at least among Greeks and Russians, and I don't know about Antiochian guys, but among Greeks and Russians, we make that, if we have red vestments on, we make the sikharion red. If we have purple vestments on, we make the sikharion purple. I always, whenever I see priests, I always say, no, eh? No. You have to have it be white. It's the baptismal robe. That's the symbolism of it. You can't be a priest without being baptized, right? Baptism is first. So, and then, this is the next passage. And the angel said to me, John writes, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Whenever you come to liturgy, or whenever you know that liturgy is going on, you are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. We believe that we participate in that reality just as much as we participate in the reality of the Lord's Supper some 2,000 years ago. And we are Christ's bride. When we miss church, let me give you a frightening statistic for Greek Orthodox. I know at St. Barnabas this is not true. But for Greek Orthodox, studies have recently been done. And remember, the Greek Orthodox are the largest Orthodox jurisdiction, a hateful word, in the United States. And in fact, if you took all the various jurisdictions and you lumped them all together, Ethiopians, Serbians, OCA, everybody, the Greeks would still be the largest. But there's a problem with that. Because now, studies have been done, and the surveys say that on any given Sunday, only 23% of all Greek Orthodox Christians are in church. Three quarters are not there. They're invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb, and they didn't show up. Good grief. Oh my God. And that says a lot about our secularity, our secularism as a church. And I want to point out to you that Father Schmemann, the late Father Alexander Schmemann's definition of secularism was that secularism is the negation of worship. In other words, all those things we're supposed to lay aside when we come into church, those things take priority in our lives. And so we forget about church because we're so wrapped up in all those things. We forget about God. We forget about Christ. We forget about the Holy Spirit. We forget about the community of believers. We forget about the saints. Because we're so wrapped up in all these other things. Okay. So, as Orthodox Christians, we need to recognize that in the liturgy that is celebrated here every Sunday and in every Orthodox church in the world, we are made one with the past, and yet we also participate in the end time. The second coming, the day of judgment. And that's why the priest can pray at the liturgy. And Father, I don't know if you read these prayers aloud here or not. At St. Paul's, I do. Just before the priest offers the gifts of bread and wine, he says, remembering, therefore, this command of our Savior. What's the command of our Savior? Do this in remembrance of me. Remembering, therefore, this command of our Savior and all that came to pass for our sake, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection on the third day, the ascension into heaven, the enthronement at the right hand of the Father, and the second and glorious coming. at each liturgy, we're remembering the second coming. Because we're already kind of participating in it. The Holy Spirit that has been given as a pledge, and the Greek word that's used by St. Paul there is arawana. Arawana is a very important word. It was used in the ancient world to describe things like a down payment. So the Holy Spirit is like a down payment on the future kingdom. We can participate in the kingdom now, but the kingdom is still to come. But the Holy Spirit gives us that down payment that makes us a new creation here and now. But also, that word can be translated as betrothal. So for example, when we do weddings at St. Paul's, if we do the wedding service in the exchange of rings, the Greek is arawanizete. Literally, it's the word arawana used as a verb. This man and this woman, they're engaged. They're pledged to one another. You see? So when we come here, it's almost as if we're celebrating our engagement and our wedding to the Lamb. You see? So we participate in the present, in the past, and in the future, all at the same time. It's why Orthodox Christians get so confused during liturgy. We like to say that the liturgy is timeless, which is why Greeks and Serbians and Arabs never go anywhere on time. And probably Coptic people are the worst, because they always start everything at least an hour late. In fact, we hosted at St. Paul's a Coptic Orthodox wedding. And the couple came to me. I said they have to have the blessing of their priest before they can do anything. They said, well, and I said at St. Paul's, I would prefer you start on time, even though your priest is going to do the service and everything. They said, well, Father, but to do that, we would have to say, the invitations would have to go out and say 4 o'clock for a 5 o'clock wedding. So, you know, and I would like to think that it's because the liturgy is timeless that we have that lack of a sense of time. At any rate, we participate in all of those realities described in that prayer. The cross, the tomb, the resurrection on the third day, the ascension into heaven, the enthronement at the right hand of the Father, and the second and glorious coming. We participate in all of those realities at every liturgy we attend. So that's really something very important that I want you to understand. The liturgy is not just about the here and now. The liturgy is about the past and the future. Do y'all have any questions about that before I go on, before I move on? You can ask questions. I'm extremely interruptible. Okay. I don't know if that's allowable here. Kevin, is that allowable here?
You want to record the questions.
You want to record the questions. I may be able to repeat the questions. But no, no questions. Means that I've probably beaten you poor people into submission. Well, I'm sorry. Let's talk about then a couple of other things. What is worship? I think that's really important. Maybe I should have even begun with that. What is worship? The word worship and the word worth in English have the same root. And ultimately, we worship what is of supreme value to us. We worship what is of ultimate worth to us. And that's important to understand. You know, even Protestants sometimes get this. You all read The Purpose-Driven Life, right? Oh, Father Wayne, you're going, I don't remember that book. Anyway, so Rick Warren, nice guy. Rick Warren tries to define what the purposes of human life are. And he says the very first purpose of human life is worship. Oh, I made the sign of the cross when I read that. Praise Jesus. You got that right. We might not agree with the style of worship. We might think he's missing a few things like incense and vestments and icons and all that. But at least he knows what the priority is. And my God, just by the statistic I read to you, how 75% or more of Greek Orthodox are not in church on any given Sunday. At least Rick Warren got that right. So worship is not a part of your life. Worship is actually all of your life. What we do here in setting aside these specific times to participate in God's kingdom, to encounter Christ, to live in the Holy Spirit, all of that is what we're to take from here. So that the very last thing we do at liturgy, by the way, is not kiss the cross, not receive our undead at all. It's exit the building. And we exit the building full of Christ, full of the Holy Spirit. And we're to take Christ and the Holy Spirit with us once we leave church. In fact, it's interesting. I'll read to you something from St. John Chrysostom. If I can find it quickly. This is St. John Chrysostom talking to us Orthodox Christians, about what it means when we leave liturgy. Let us leave the divine liturgy like lions breathing fire, having become fearsome to the devil, because we have received the holy body and blood of the Lord. By this we have been given great power. The blood chases demons away and brings the angels near to us. The blood is the salvation of our souls. With this blood, the soul is washed clean and made beautiful. This blood makes our minds brighter than fire. So encourage our brothers and sisters who are absent. See, brothers and sisters were even absent in the 4th century, right? So encourage our brothers and sisters who are absent to come to church. Exhort those who are deceived by demons and stay away to return. Teach that whoever doesn't attend church, that you sang hymns with the seraphim, that you belong to heaven even now, and that you met with Christ and spoke with him. Counsel them not only with words, but also by how you live. That's key. You know they say talk is cheap, right? It's how you live that makes the difference. However, even if you don't say anything but merely come out of the divine liturgy showing those who are absent from worship, the gain you've received from church simply by your appearance, by your gaze and your voice, by the way you walk and with all the spiritual power you've received, that would be enough for exhortation and counsel. Because the truth is, the truth is that we should come out of the church as if we were descending from heaven itself. If we live the divine liturgy thus, we will not have to say anything to those who are absent. For seeing how we have benefited, they will learn what they've missed and will quickly run to church to delight in the grace and loving kindness of our Lord Jesus Christ. So, have you ever thought of yourselves as lions breathing fire when you leave liturgy on Sunday morning? Probably not. But St. John Chrysostom says, well, maybe you should start thinking of yourself that way. Because you're full of Christ. You're full of the Holy Spirit. It's like you've just descended from heaven. Now, we actually believe... Let me see if I can find this quickly. I was reading an article, actually, yesterday, about St. Ephrem. You all know who St. Ephrem is, right? Oh, Lord and Master of my life. You know that prayer, right? I was reading an article about St. Ephrem. And he wrote many hymns, and some of them are on the Lord's Supper. Some of them are on the mystical supper. Here's what he says. He, meaning Jesus, broke the bread with his own hands in token of the sacrifice of his body. He mixed the cup with his own hands in token of the sacrifice of his blood. He offered himself up in sacrifice the great high priest of our atonement. A little bit further down, he says what happens to us. He says, when we receive communion now, in a new way, his body is kneaded into our body. His pure blood is poured forth into our arteries. His voice is in our ears. His appearance in our eyes. And by reason of his compassion, all of him is kneaded into us. Do you understand the word knead? You know, to knead a loaf of bread, to work the dough, you know, until you get that crust right. Okay? Knead the dough. When you receive communion, you have the blood of Christ flowing through your veins. You have Jesus literally flowing through your veins. That's what we believe. The body of Christ that we eat becomes part and parcel of our body. And all of that is about what St. Ignatius of Antioch called receiving the medicine of immortality. The pharmakon, it's the word we get pharmacy from. The pharmakon tis athanasias. The medicine of immortality. In other words, we are all dying. All of us are dying. And when we come to church, and when we participate in the body and blood of Christ, when we receive communion, we believe that our mortality is being put into remission. There is probably no one here whose life has not been touched by someone who's had cancer. I have never known a cancer patient to miss a chemotherapy appointment or a radiation appointment, unless they're already dead. We need to see how desperate we are for communion. Because communion puts our mortality into remission. Christ created us for immortality, but we turned away from that into mortality. That's what the fall of the human race is all about. And when we speak about corruption in the liturgy and in many of the prayer services of our church, we do not simply mean the corruption of our minds and hearts in a moral way. We mean that. But we also mean the corruption of our bodies after we're dead. That we return to the dust from which we were taken. That Christ makes our death in this world our Good Friday. And when you think about Good Friday, and if any of you have ever been to an Orthodox funeral, you know that on Good Friday, at 3 o'clock, we take Christ's body down to the cross, carry the procession around the church, and here in the center of the church, we also have the tomb of Christ, right, decorated with flowers. And we place Christ in the tomb. It's Good Friday. But Easter is coming. Pascha's around the corner. The resurrection of Christ is around the corner. And the resurrection of the dead is around the corner for us. So notice what happens. I don't know if this happens here. I assume it does. The deceased is brought into the church in procession. The coffin is here. It's placed in the center of the church. Sometimes there's a casket spray on them, flowers, just like the kabukli, just like the tomb of Christ, right? It's our Good Friday when we die. But we hope in the resurrection. And in fact, that's why in the scripture readings from Thessalonians that we read at every funeral service, that letter of St. Paul, he says, Christians do not grieve the way others do that have no hope. We have hope because we know Jesus rose from the dead. That's why we say, Christ is risen over and over and over and over and over again to get that into our minds and hearts so that we can actually live that reality once we leave church. So when we receive communion, Christ becomes part of us and puts to death our death. So communion is essential for eternal life. Communion is essential for eternal life. That's really important for you to understand. In fact, the Lord Jesus even says that in the Gospels. You know, in the Gospel of John, what the Lord Jesus says. It's in John chapter 6. He says, well, I should read it to you. I practically know it by heart at this point because I quote it so often. John says, John says that Jesus says, these are to the Jews who are following him, listening to his teaching. He's actually preaching this at the synagogue in Capernaum. Father Michael and I, we went to the synagogue in Capernaum. Still there. Okay? You can go, you can stand in the proximity of where the Lord Jesus preached and taught this very thing I'm going to read to you. So Jesus said to them, Amen, amen, I say unto you. Normally that's translated as truly, truly. I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is truly food, and my blood is truly drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood lives in me, and I live in him. Just what we were just talking about. As the living Father has sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who eats of me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven. And then it ends, verse 59. This he said in the synagogue, as he taught. So communion is essential. If you're an Orthodox Christian and you know the truth of the gospel about this, and you do not participate in it, it's a big problem. It's a big problem. Now, sometimes, and you know, I'm sure, most other churches don't have this. Evangelical churches, non-denominational churches, they don't understand things the same way. Catholics do, kind of. They do. But Protestant churches, by and large, don't. And I just want to tell you this story. It's an interesting, to me at least, aside. When I was serving as a priest in Seattle, there was a woman, a family, whose house I went to bless. And at that time in Seattle, I was doing a Bible study in the morning and a Bible study in the evening to give people as much opportunity as possible to come and study the scriptures. And while we were talking after I blessed the home, the wife said to me, "Oh, Father, I'm going to this neighborhood Bible study." And there are about 20 women, 25 women who go. And Father, it's non-denominational. And I just kind of looked at her. Because you know what non-denominational means, don't you? It just means you're Protestant but don't want to admit it. Right? Non-denominational. There is no such thing. Period. So I said, well, what book of the Bible are you reading right now? What book of the Bible are you studying? And she said, we're doing John's Gospel. And so did they give you, like, notes about that or a book you're supposed to be doing? Oh, yes, they do. I said, go get it for me. And so she brought out this big, big notebook about the Gospel of John. And I said, have you gotten to John chapter 6 yet? She said, no. We just started. I said, find out where in all those notes John chapter 6 is. Start with verse 53 and tell me, how are those passages interpreted? So she looked through this non-denominational Bible study material, and she discovered that, because I read the passage to her, she discovered that in this particular Bible study she was doing, it said, all of that means you're supposed to read your Bible more. I looked at her, because she was of Greek background, raised in the church, and I said to her, do you think that's what that's about? She looked at me very sheepishly and said, no, isn't that about communion? Yes, it is about communion. Thank God. Thank God. People oftentimes misunderstand the scriptures. And that's where, as Orthodox Christians, we have something of an advantage. Because we have a whole tradition of faith and life that's been going on for 2,000 years. And even before that, when we count the Old Testament, we would say we all go back to Abraham. Because St. Paul will say, in Christ, in our baptisms, we become children of Abraham. So our spiritual ancestry is actually Jewish. Now, let's come back to worship. I hope you understand the importance of communion. How to prepare for communion. When I was a kid growing up in the church, I was taught by my yaya, my grandmother, that I should only receive communion maximum 4 times a year. 3 would be better. But if necessary, 4. Okay? And what were those days? All of you guys raised in the church, you should know those days. Obviously, they're Pascha, Christmas, what else? Feast of the Dormition, Theotokos, you know. Maybe your name day, if they have liturgy on your name day. You know. And you all know that if you were raised in the church, you began fasting the Sunday before. And basically you ate peanut butter and jelly all week. You had water. And your parents monitored you like hawks. You know. And that was your basic preparation to receive communion. And of course, now I'm speaking about Greeks. Food is very important to us. We should all come to our Greek festival in a few weeks. Food is very important to us. So, fasting was looked at as the primary way of preparing for communion. And fasting is really important. You have to fast. No questions. But I think we would want to say that in the liturgy, if you listen carefully, when the priest comes out, or the deacon comes out with the chalice, he does not say, with fasting, fear, and whatever, draw near, come forth. No mention of fasting. What's mentioned? With the fear of God, faith, and love. Right? And by the way, those of you who think the liturgy never changes, let me disabuse you of that notion. If you go to a Russian Orthodox church, the announcement is, with the fear of God and faith, draw near. No love in there. Okay?
No. You just say with faith and love.
Where?
In Rokor?
Yeah. Okay. If you go to Russia, it's not in there. Yes.
I believe that the Greek standing up can go back far enough and say love either. I'm told that's an Athenite tradition.
It is. In fact, the Kolevades fathers on Mount Athos added that word love in the 18th century. So the liturgy does change. We are not celebrating the same liturgy as John Chrysostom celebrated in its details. The essence is there, of course. But the details change. The details vary. So with faith, with the fear of God, with love, That's how we draw near. Now, think about this. Fear God and keep His commandments. That's what it says in Ecclesiastes. For this is the duty of every human being. We approach the communion because in our fear of God, we keep His commandments. We fear the Lord your God and serve Him alone. You know, and there are many, many passages in Scripture. You who fear the Lord, praise Him. The Lord delights in those who fear Him, who put their hope in His unfailing love. Blessed are all those who fear the Lord and walk in obedience to Him. Through the fear of the Lord, evil is avoided. To fear God is to hate evil. Those who are wise fear God and shun evil. Those are all passages, mostly from the Old Testament, from Psalms and Proverbs and so forth. So notice what it says. So the fear of God is a way of living in which we hate evil, avoid it and shun it, cleanse ourselves from every defilement of flesh and spirit, keep His commandments, walk in obedience to Him, and serve Him alone in all sincerity, praising Him and giving Him glory. If you go to any concordance, just look up the phrase, fear of God or fear of the Lord, dozens and dozens of passages will show up. So, fear of God. That's how we're to approach this. And notice that fear of God in the Scriptures is a whole way of life, living your life in obedience to God, serving Him alone. See? With faith. Well, first of all, in Hebrews it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you have to have faith. The righteous are the ones who live by faith, St. Paul writes. And notice that in James, it says, faith without works is dead. Faith without works is useless. In fact, James will even say, Abraham's faith was made complete by his works. So even mentioning the very word faith implies the works. With the fear of God, with faith, and all the works that go along with faith. What are some of the works that go along with faith? What will we be judged on the day of judgment? What scripture passage do we read on Judgment Sunday before Lent? Does the deacon have to answer every question? What do we read? We read from Matthew chapter 25. About the righteous and the damned, the sheep and the goats. And notice they're all surprised where they end up. The righteous are surprised that they're righteous, and the damned are surprised that they're damned. But notice what the Lord Jesus says. He says, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was sick and you visited me. In other words, very concrete, specific actions of compassion and care for those people who are less fortunate than we are. Okay? Those are the kinds of works that go along with faith. And there's much, much else that we can discuss. But we won't today because I'm running out of time, as Kevin has said. Anyway, let's look at love for a moment. You all know what the Lord Jesus says. When you come for communion, you need to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Think about that. Most of our days are spent loving ourselves, right? And to think that we're going to love somebody else as much as we love ourselves, that's very rare in human life. Maybe our mothers do that. Okay? Sometimes our fathers. But very rare. Very rare. Something very precious. So, if you want to understand about preparing for communion, besides the fasting, besides the physical discipline, besides reciting a canon of repentance before receiving communion the night before, besides all of that, in addition to all of that. If you want to know how you're doing spiritually in preparation for communion with regards to love, you just need to read St. Paul. It's 1 Corinthians, right? Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not boast. Love is not arrogance. Love does not dishonor others. Love is not self-seeking. You want to know how you're doing? Put your name there. Steve is patient.
No.
Steve is kind. Very seldom. Steve does not envy and does not boast. Steve is not arrogant. Steve does not dishonor others. Steve is not self-seeking. Steve is not easily angered and keeps no record of wrongs. Steve does not delight in evil but rejoices in the truth. Steve always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Does that describe you? If that describes you, you're ready for communion. And that's the key thing for you to understand. Receiving communion is essential, but receiving communion is a double-edged sword. You can receive communion, as our prayers say, unto judgment or condemnation. Right? And that's important for you to understand because that actually just comes from the scriptures. So let's see if I can find that and I'll read it to you. In fact, all of you actually, I hope, should have this handout. If you don't, this is my last one and I'll give it to you. But if you open it up, one of the things that you'll see here of why we use incense and so forth. In other words, I want you to understand that the way we worship is not something we made up. It's something we enter into. And therefore, it already has a form and shape of its own, which we are to conform to. That's why we use incense. That's why there are bishops, presbyters, and deacons and so forth. So if you turn to page 5, up at the top of the page, this is from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. It's chapter 11. Okay. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Greek word there is paradidome. It's the word tradition as a verb. What I also traditioned on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Now continue on. "Therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord." That's the New International Version translation. In the original Greek, the word guilty is not in there. You're just unworthy. Okay? In fact, in the entire New Testament, there is not one word in the original Greek that could be translated by the modern English word guilt. The Lord Jesus says, repent. Change your mind. Change the way you think about God, the world, and yourself. He never says feel guilty. Okay? "So whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner sins against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." And this, he says to the Corinthians, and this you need to listen to. "That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep." In other words, you've died. "But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment." In other words, we believe that you can actually receive communion in a manner that is unworthy of the Lord. And you can get sick and die. Communion is a double-edged sword. That's why we pray those prayers. Not unto judgment and condemnation, but unto the forgiveness of my sins and everlasting life, eternal life. Because St. Paul says this to the Corinthians. My crazy ancestors, by the way. My ancestors came from a small village about 40 kilometers north of Corinth. And so my ancestors were so bad, St. Paul didn't write one letter, he had to write two to straighten them out. Okay. Now, you have to understand, communion in that sense is a double-edged sword. And I would venture to say that if you only focus on food and not fear of God, faith, and the works that go along with it, and love, you're not fully prepared because you don't fully understand what the Christian life is. Does that make sense? So, in the liturgy, to prepare for the liturgy, there is both exterior work that we need to do and interior work in the heart and mind. And it's those attitudes, fear of God, faith, and love. That's the reason we fast, to develop those in us. That's the reason we pray, to develop those in us. That's the reason why we do every spiritual discipline in the church, to develop those frames of mind in us, mind and heart, I should say. So, does that all make sense? Now, one more passage from the scriptures, and then I'll stop. Am I supposed to stop now, Kevin?
We're getting close.
We're getting close. He's such a nice guy. Yeah. He told me I was supposed to speak for an hour. It's already almost 11:30. I want to read to you from Romans. Because we believe that what defines us as human beings is worship. When I was a kid in college, I was told that human beings were Homo sapiens. This is an anthropology class. Homo sapiens. Latin for being wise, right? And, you know, that name for the human race was first come up with at the beginning of the 20th century, maybe even a little bit before in the 19th century. I don't recall exactly now. And then we went through World War I and World War II, and some anthropologists began to say, well, maybe we're not so wise. Maybe we better change that name. So for a while, we were called Homo faber. The word we get fabricate from in Latin. In other words, we make tools, and that separates us from animals. But then, we discovered, observing chimpanzees in the wild, that a chimpanzee will take a twig and break it off a tree, run it through his mouth, and stick it down an anthill, and pulls out all those ants. He made a tool. So, not wanting to be thought of as chimpanzees, we went back to Homo sapiens. Father Schmemann used to describe the human race as Homo adorans, that as human beings, we are innately religious, innately created to worship, to adore. And when we do not worship, everything else goes awry. So let me read to you from Romans. So, it's Romans chapter 1, which, as you know, St. Paul is describing the human race, Jews and Gentiles, and how completely messed up we are. Okay? For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and wickedness of men, who by their evil wickedness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain, because God has shown it to them. Ever since the creation of the world, His invisible nature, namely His eternal power and His deity, His theotis, has been clearly perceived in the things that have been made. So we get some sense of this when we look up into a night sky and we can really see the stars. You really can't see the stars in one town. I went to Africa a few years ago and there are no lights in the bush at all. And I can see the Milky Way. The first time in my life I've ever done so. It was amazing. And the bishop I was with said to me, see how God has decorated the night sky. In other words, when we look at that and we see that immensity, it should remind us that There's something more than just us. Okay? His eternal power and deity have been clearly perceived in the things that have been made. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their senseless minds were darkened. Now, this is what Father Sherman would say about that passage, and you have it, I think, that you're not Father Michael. He would say, the Greek there is edoxasan e evcharistisan. They did not give him glory or thanksgiving. Those are the Greek words, and doxa is glory. It's the root of Orthodox, right? It's the root of the word Orthodox. We did not give him glory. The human race did not give him glory. Did not worship him. And did not give thanks to him. Eucharistia, which by the way, is one of the names of the liturgy. The Eucharist. Right? Even in modern Greek, Eucharistia just simply means thank you. Even in colloquial language. And then St. Paul begins to describe how everything has gone awry. Because we do not glorify God, we do not worship God, and we do not offer him the Eucharist. We do not Eucharistize the world, so to speak, in our worship. He says, claiming to be wise, they became futile in their thinking and their senseless minds. This translation has, actually the Greek word is kardia, heart. Their senseless hearts were darkened. So our hearts are dark. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal men or birds or animals or reptiles, all the idols, so to speak. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts. Notice, it doesn't say God punished them because of this. God said, okay, you're going to do this. I mean, I'm not, you know, you're going to have to deal with the consequences. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature, the creation, rather than the Creator, who is blessed unto the ages of ages. Amen. And then, of course, it goes on to describe all the stuff that's wrong with us. So when we are not worshiping the one true and living God, we really get all messed up. Really get all messed up. And it's important for you to understand that you come here to put yourself right, to worship God, to put yourself right with him, to be healed by him, to be made whole by him. Because right now, you are fragmented, you are broken, you are distracted, you are sinful, and we come here to have all that put into remission. The liturgy is so important that I wanted to read you something about a gentleman in Russia in the 1970s. In the 1970s in Russia, you could be arrested for holding religious education classes in your apartment in Moscow. And there was a man who did that. His name was Alexander Ogorodnikov. He was arrested, he was thrown in jail, he spent years in prison. And this is how he describes being in prison. He says, he tells how he celebrated the liturgy in his heart every day. These are in his memoirs. The greatest miracle of all is prayer. Remember, he's in prison. I have only to turn my thoughts to God, and suddenly I feel a force bursting into me. There's new strength in my soul and my entire being. The basis of my whole spiritual life is the Orthodox liturgy. So while I was in prison, I attended it every day in my imagination. At 8 o'clock in the morning, I would begin walking around my cell, repeating its words to myself. And I realized I was then inseparably linked to the whole Christian world. In the Great Litany, I would pray, not only for Orthodox bishops like the Ecumenical Patriarch, but even for the Pope, as well as for the leaders of my own church in Russia. At the central point of the liturgy, I felt myself standing before the face of the Lord, sensing almost physically his wounded, bleeding body. I would begin at that point praying in my own words, remembering all those near to me, those in prison and those who were free, those who were still alive and those who had died. More and more names kept welling up from my memory. The prison walls moved apart, and the whole universe became my residence, visible and invisible, the universe for which that wounded, pierced body offered itself as a sacrifice. After this, I experienced an exaltation of spirit all day. I felt purified within. Not only my own prayer helped me, but even more, the prayer of many other faithful Christians. I felt it continually, working from a distance, lifting me up as though on wings, giving me living water and the bread of life, peace of soul, rest, and love. So, remember what he writes about the experience of the liturgy, and remember what St. John Chrysostom says about what should happen when you read liturgy on a Sunday. Kevin, I should shut up now, don't you think?
I'm not open for questions.
Now it's open for questions. Nobody had any questions. Yes. Oh, we're going to stick a microphone in your face. Okay.
I noticed when you were discussing the necessary preparation for communion, you did not mention confession. I know not all jurisdictions confess as frequently as others, but I personally find confession to be a good place for spiritual education.
Absolutely.
And to get on track. Absolutely. And get some of those heretical or misguided thoughts out of my head. So maybe
you have heretical and misguided thoughts?
Oh, of course.
Like the rest of us. Oh, no.
So maybe could you speak about the need for confession?
Sure, absolutely. One of the passages I read, I should have talked about confession. Thank you for pointing that out, by the way. One of the passages I read to you from Scriptures, St. Paul says, let a man examine himself, therefore, before he comes to communion. You know the old saying about a man who has himself for a doctor, has a fool for a doctor? I think we can examine ourselves in a very limited way. But self-knowledge is not a great strength of most human beings. So it's always very valuable to go to confession. Now, confession, I'll talk about it a little bit in Greek, exomologesis. The Greek word exomologesis, exo, the prefix, means to get it out. And so when you go to confession, the whole point of confession is to get it out. Get out all the stuff that's in you that is separating you from God, that is separating you from being, really, a Christian at a deep, deep level. Right? And really, you have to understand also, I do want you to understand this, because many times people come and they say, they're afraid to go to confession, because they're afraid of what the priest might think about them. They really tell the truth about what's going on in their lives. And first of all, I guess what I'd say is that every priest always begins with the assumption that you're at least as screwed up as he is. And that means you're in deep trouble. Okay? So don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. You have to come to confession and get everything out. Now, different jurisdictions do different things with regards to confession. So, in Rokor, I'm assuming that the Russian custom still is, you go to confession before every communion. It's once a week. Okay. Other jurisdictions don't have kind of a once a week rule with regard to confession. In the Greek Archdiocese, we say you should come to confession a minimum of 4 times a year, and every other time that you need to, which is actually more often than most people think. But certainly during the times of the great fasts of the church, Great Lent, obviously, you know, the fast of the Dormition, the fast before Christmas, the Apostles' Fast, you should be coming to confession those times. And other times as you need to, you see. So we have a practice of going to confession every week. We're going to confession four times a year. Actually, in Russia, originally the law was every Russian Orthodox person, that was a law passed by the Tsar, had to come to confession and communion once a year because so few people ever came forward for communion. You have to go to confession and communion once a year. And if you can imagine this, I know it's never happened in St. Louis, but once when I was in Greece in Seattle, I celebrated the liturgy. And I came out with the chalice. No one came forward. No one.
Zero.
So the chanter began to sing. We have seen a true light, you know. Stop! There is no one here that has seen anything yet. Because no one can take communion. Forget about that here. Okay? And so I did say to the chanter, who was a very devout and pious man, I said, my brother, you are to be certain that there is at least one person here that will receive communion, even if that's only you. And so he did. He always saw to it that there was someone else there, or he took communion. He was always prepared. And that's the key thing. We have to always be prepared. Our preparation for communion is our whole life. And confession is an extremely valuable tool in looking at our lives and getting our lives in order. So you're absolutely right. Thank you for bringing up confession. Thank you. Any other kinds of questions? Yes, sir.
So my question kind of piggybacks on hers. You know, I know people that Russians take, you know, they take confession, you know, like every week. Then I know people that take confession once a year. The balance for me is a little bit confusing because I know that sometimes I feel unworthy of taking of the chalice. But I know also you're not necessarily supposed to withhold yourself from it. Like, it's not really your choice to do that. So I guess what I want to know is, you know, where is the balance in that? What, when is it like perfectly acceptable to withhold yourself from the sacrament?
From the sacrament, from communion. Okay, we'll talk about that. But Paul College was aware, once made the remark at St. Paul's, that he is for frequent communion, but not for casual communion. And I would agree with that, and I think every priest would. If going to communion, if you're approaching the chalice in a way that seems too casual, stop what you're doing. Go talk to Father Wayne. Go talk to another priest, Father Michael, whoever. Just stop. Because you need to have some sense of the fear of God, some sense of the reverence and the awe that you're about to take Christ himself into your own body and into your own blood. But the preparation for communion is not merely some of the externals. And then, like we fast, you know, remember I said to you, I was taught to fast, and then you're worthy to receive communion. No. You can fast until you are blue in the face. But that in and of itself does not prepare you for communion. Your whole life is in preparation for communion. And in fact, we would even say, I think, certainly St. John Cassian says, he says that if you feel yourself worthy of communion, that's probably the time when you should go. When you really feel that you're completely messed up and that you are desperate for Christ, that's when you should go. When you feel yourself completely unworthy of so great a gift, that you realize it is completely grace, freely given to you by God, has nothing to do with your, I don't know, perceived understanding of yourself as being righteous and holy. It is pure gift. And if you approach the chalice with that sense, you can come every Sunday. You can come every day. But if you begin to think, oh, I'm really kind of cool, I'm pretty good at Christianity stuff, it's not as hard as I thought. Stop. Don't receive them. Because you really then, at that point, it's become casual rather than something that evokes fear and awe and love and faith. Does that make sense? Any other kinds of questions? Those are both very good questions, by the way. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, Kevin, you rascal. Edit that phrase out, by the way. I think we're done, and so I'm just going to turn off my microphone, and we'll call it a day. Thank you all for coming out. Great.